Village Development Authority. Good to see you.
Pressure also as the economy grows at 6 to 7% year on year, and Metro Manila contributes to the value creation of the economy. Then there's also an increasing pressure on the city, particularly when it comes to the quality of life and competitiveness. We are presenting the future, an alternative which we could build now, and this would further enhance the development of our cities, particularly Manila, and create opportunities in the surrounding communities in the entire country. And I present to you the Clark Green City. Well, just to give you a background of what BCDA is all about, well, we were born out of adversity. We were created by the Philippine Congress in 1992 to address certain challenges that the country had faced. You remember in 1986, we were able to depose a dictator, but we were left with almost a bankrupt economy, which was plundered by the cronies. And we were having a very young democracy, but a year after the ends of people power, we had a series of coup d'etat which subsisted until 1989, the bloodiest of which is in December 1st of 1989, when military rebels occupied the Makati Financial District. And it isolated the Philippine economy from global investment community. Then, to make matters worse, after the last coup d'etat, we had the Baguio earthquake, which devastated central Luzon and northern Luzon. And then, after the earthquake, a year after the earthquake, we had the most destructive volcanic eruption, which is the Mount Pinatubo eruption, which devastated central Luzon and others and the surrounding communities. So you have these challenges. You have a very young democracy threatened by political instability, group of rebels, military rebels, communist rebels, Muslim secessionists. You have an almost bankrupt economy, and then you're isolated from the global investment community. Then we had to make a decision as a young sovereign nation whether to renew the military peace agreement, and because of the need to assert our identity as an independent sovereign country, our Senate had decided to not renew the U.S. military bases agreement, and instead transform these military bases into what you see now in the Freeport Zone. But that decision had a great economic impact in the country also, because the people affected by that decision are the thousands of families who are also suffering from the devastation of Mount Pinatubo. So at the time that Clark Air Base was abandoned by the U.S. Air Force, about 7,000 Filipinos had been working in that area, and much more in Subic. But these are the people who are directly suffering from Mount Pinatubo eruption. So we came up with President Cory Aquino, created a team from the legislative and the executive to craft the basis conversion program. And that was drafted in 1990, and by the time that the U.S. Military had left, we were able to pass a law in 1992, which became the basis conversion law, and which created BCDA under Republic Act 727. So because of the challenges, we were given by Congress with special power. BCDA is probably the only organization in the country which has this kind of power and features. We are mandate is basically to develop the former military bases and to also contribute to the modernization of the armed forces. We are basically a revenue generator for the government. We are proud to say we do not spend taxpayers' money. We actually contribute more to the national treasury. So, and because of this also, we're given special powers, not ordinarily given to any entity. We have the legislative franchise for any kind of infrastructure. Tollway, railway, seaport, airport, power plant, irrigation system. We can do that, and under our law, we are authorized to do that. We are able to, we are given by a power to acquire, own, hold, and administer any kind of property, and to dispose them, to cover them, to generate revenues for the government. And I think the most critical one is the power to expropriate, which is not normally given to any entity, as a corporation, or any government, any government agency. So we were able to do this and exercise this power in completing the SETEX, the Subic Quadra Expressway project in record time. We were able to acquire the right way and build the tollway in 3 years' time, which is a record time when it comes to public infrastructure of that magnitude in the Philippines. It's a 94-kilometer tollway. You probably used it. It's one of the most beautiful tollways that we have in the country, which gave birth to another two tollways, the Thiklex, Tarlac-Pangasinan-Logan Expressway, and the third tollway, which is the Central Luzon Expressway, moving towards the Tabanatuman side. Next. So, this is the, you look at the map, these red dots are all BCDA projects and assets. And this, you see that on the map of the Philippines, we basically cover about a third of the Philippine population. And our greater vision is to connect all these red dots with basic infrastructure that would hasten the development of these red dots as economic centers. I think we've been very successful already in Metro Manila. You see Bonifacio Global City, you see Terminal 3. The land where Terminal 3 is located is actually owned by BCDA. The airport authority is leasing it from us. Then across the street from the Terminal 3, you see Resort World and the development of Mega World. That's our project also, in partnership with Mega World, forward towards Bonifacio Global City, and it's continuing to grow. Then moving to towards Central Luzon, you see our biggest land holding in Clark. Then we have a 365-hectare property in Morong Batan, which is about 9 kilometers away from Subic. Then we connected the Subic Freeport Zone directly to the airport. This is the only infrastructure and the only freeport zones that you could find where the seaport and the airport are directly linked by high-speed tollway on a gate-to-gate basis. So you see that, and then eventually we'll be integrating all the tollways so that you can only, we will reduce all the toll plazas and you will only get the ticket on the toll, on the entry, and then pay at the exit. So, and then moving up, you see the John Hayes Special Economic Zone. That's a 600-hectare property. We are taking over again that property for further redevelopment. And then in, an hour away from it is a seaport and an airport, small seaport and an airport, which could serve as the gateway to the north, and which is the 4-point Special Economic Zone. So we are actually probably the biggest landowner in the Philippines when it comes to alienable and disposable lands, with about 41,500 hectares of prime land. Under the new law of the Armed Forces Modernization, we are given the authority also to develop additional 330,000 hectares of land all over the Philippines, in Mindanao, Visayas, and Luzon. So we are a $10 billion company in terms of asset value. We have one tollway, two seaports, three airports, and all the real estate that you could find in Manila, the biggest one. So this is the Bonifacio Global City. Currently, it's about 45% that developed. This is the McKinley Hill, the McKinley West, which I'm quite proud to say I was able to acquire that, to recover that from a case which I won in the Supreme Court, and now it's being developed at a 35-hectare urban development. This is the Clark Freeport Zone, which has about, when the Americans left, there are about 7,000 Filipinos working here. Now, there are 85,000 Filipinos working right here and increasing. By 2017, by the expansion plans that our locators have presented, by 2017, we will reach about 100,000 jobs right in this Freeport zone. Then we have the, of course, the Subic Freeport zone, which is the maritime center of the region. We have Hanjin, which is the, one of the biggest shipyard, shipbuilding companies in the world. Then, of course, is the Bataan Technology Park. This used to be the Philippine Refugee Processing Center. The Philippines were quite open to providing sanctuary to refugees, and we hosted about 500,000 refugees coming from Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos. Now we're able to transform this into another special economic zone, and we're looking for partners with it. This is about a kilometer away from Ambayaco, if you're familiar with the area. And this is the 4.34 zone. We have our own seaport, and we have our own airport here, which could accommodate A320s. We're looking for revitalizing the commercial flights going here, because this is a gateway to Baguio, to the Cordillera, to the heritage sites of Ilocos Sur, to the surfing sites of La Union and Pangasinan. And you see this, there's already an existing development, a 9-hole golf course, which is being managed by Thunderbird. There's a resort hotel development as well in that area. And this is a master plan, which Rotary was drawn up by the Palafox firm. So this is the, we're also looking at probably having cruises at the dock at the seaport here. So this is a beautiful master plan we're looking now for partners. This is another important special economic zone, which has its incentives. So this is the Jolly Special Economic Zone. We are going to take over this. The court has already ruled in our favor. Well, it will take some time, but eventually this is going to be redeveloped. This is the SETEX, the 94-kilometer tollway. We built it for $600 million, the longest tollway in the Philippines. You see that how beautiful that tollway is paved. And now this is the Clark Green City, the future of the city building in the Philippines. We're happy that the earlier presenter Jeremy had mentioned about what the city should look like, and I'm quite happy that we're going to the right direction. So this is a Clark Green City. We envision the city. Well, Singapore is a city in a garden. Right here, Clark Green City is a city in a park. Well, because this would be surrounded by farms, and it has urban farm right in the middle, with a lot of green spaces and farms. This is the reason why we need to build this. Well, the Manila continues to grow, and definitely it's unstoppable. But we have a growing population. We have reached the 100 million mark, and we continue to grow. Right in this region is one of the fastest growing regions. The population grows here at 2.48%. That's why you see malls coming up. And this is also the second biggest population of our migrant workers. So the consumption here is increasing. It is located in all the basic infrastructure. You see the NLEX moving up to Clark, then SETEX, then you have TPLEX, and then you have CLEX moving to the Pacific side. Right in the middle is Clark. You see that location, and eventually we're going to build a railway that will connect it to Manila and connect it to the airport. Now, of course, there's a business process outsourcing industry boom, which makes also the demand for office space in Manila higher and higher, and therefore some of the companies are now looking for alternatives where they could find the lower rental rate for office spaces. Now, the vital infrastructures are there. We have our own seaport in Subic, currently underutilized. This is one of the most beautiful seaports that we have. In fact, aircraft carriers that dock here. The biggest ships can dock here. Then we have the biggest airport in the Philippines in terms of land area. Manila Airport is about 600 hectares. The Clark Airport is 2,500 hectares with two parallel runways. We just need to build the terminal and create the connectivity. Then, this is the first city also that is an entirely special economic zone. Why is it important? Well, because as a special economic zone, it allows 100% foreign-owned company to participate in the development. And there's a tax regime which is unusual, which is quite special, considering that the ordinary corporate income tax is higher, about 32%. But here, the locators would only pay 5% for their gross income. That is a substantial reduction in your tax burden and creates, and there's a duty-free importation of capital and equipment. If you're building a hospital or a green building, then this technology, which could be probably expensive, but because it's duty-free, then the cost is lower. Then there's a one-stop shop for, because it's a special economic zone, so there's a one-stop shop in getting visa, processing your permits, and we have a full control of the development because it's carved out of the local government unit, so we have our own governance mechanism within the special economic zone. Of course, this area also is a very safe location for a city. You would see that right in this location, it is protected from super typhoons from the west, from the Pacific side, by the Sierra Madre mountain range. Right here is a very big mountain range that protects if there's a super typhoon as strong as Haiyan or Yolanda, it will first hit the mountains and weaken before it could reach this area. And there's another one coming from the West Philippine side. There's the Zambales mountain range right here. It's actually nestled between two mountain ranges. And this is a very high elevation. The lowest point of this city is 53 meters above sea level. That is one of the highest points in Metro Manila. And that's the reason why the Americans chose this as an Air Force base. So, and it's right located in the central plain of Luzon, where food and agriculture is thriving. So that's why we envision it as a city within a farm, because exactly it is surrounded by all the farmlands, the food basket of the Philippines. So it's also, it doesn't have any fault line. Also, it's not located in any fault line. The nearest fault line is the East Zambales fault line, which is 25 kilometers away from it. So it's a high elevation, protected by mountain ranges, has no fault line in this area, and a special economic zone, and with all the locations, with all the infrastructures already built. So this is how the city would look like. This is a concept plan which we had undertaken an international design competition, which ACOM, which is a master planning firm, had won. And we envisioned the city to be populated by about 1.2 million people, creating 800,000 jobs. We take green seriously, and we are creating metrics, performance indicators that would define the city as green. We will include this in the design guidelines and restrictions as we move towards the design plan, the detailed design planning of every part of the development. So this is one of the key innovations in the city, and I would have to admit our biggest mistake in building BGC, Bonifacio Global City, is the lack of affordable housing. We have observed that as the city grew, the slums beside it also grew, because workers in BGC cannot afford buying a condominium apartment in BGC. I would have an apartment in BGC. I cannot afford it myself. So, but people who are working in BPOs, thousands of them, would need accommodation, and therefore a demand for space in the slums has increased, and that's the reason for the growth of the slums. But you know, affordable housing need not be in the slums. We believe that it's important that as city builders, we must provide an inclusive community where minimum wage, even the minimum wage earners, can live in the city, so that this would not be a city for the rich only, but a city for everyone. So we have signed an agreement with Pagibig, which is our housing fund, to build 2,000 townhouses, affordable townhouses, for rental housing. And our benchmark is that these houses must be rented by, even by the minimum wage earner. Because we have, in our studies, in our own projects, in our own failures, we discovered that poor people cannot immediately migrate from homelessness to home ownership. Because to own a home, you have to be at least a middle class. There are commensurate responsibilities and burden in owning a home. And you must have the capacity, economic capacity, of at least a middle class to own a home, but from homelessness. So there is a gap, and that we're creating that gap so that we will not at the same time crowd out private developers who are selling the home. So we're creating that kind of bridge in here. So in Clark City, we have 85,000 workers, 2,000 townhouses could immediately be taken up by the workers there. So there'll be a lot of, all the roads will have bike lanes. So for bikers, this city is for you. For walkers and runners, this city is for you. Because the sidewalk will be very, very wide. We will ensure that all the sidewalks will be fit for running and walking. So this is the full development. We expect that it will be populated by 1.2 million people and creating 800,000 jobs. So this is a complete community. So you would see that the way you envision the city, how the city will grow, is the growth of central business districts combined. So you could see, by in the map, this looks like small scale, but in reality, if you go to the ground, this is 3,500 hectares cluster development. You could expect all the central business districts of Manila situated right next to each other. So this would be walkable central business mixed uses, and that's the beauty and the success of BGC. If you actually walk, if you live and work in BGC, you don't need a car. You just need to walk or bike going there. Okay, so, and right there, you see the farms surrounding the city, and within the city itself are urban farms and parks. That is a very big central park with a water impounding lake. That would be the source of, well, in BGC, we have this technology in Burgos Circle, where you have this water detention pond that controls the water so that there'll be no flooding in the city. Right here is we have a lake, which is the source of irrigation and also attraction for people. So they have theaters right in this park, museums, and other institutions. UP is going to build their own campus here. We have signed a memorandum agreement. So we will. This will also be a city for the geeks and the creative people. We are providing space and nominal leases for those who are involved in innovation, animation, creation, even the engineers and scientists. So this is how the land use would look like. We have industrial estate right on the top of it. So that would create the jobs that the city would need. Well, right there at the bottom, we have already have 85,000 people and increasing. So the demand for housing, commercial spaces, hospital healthcare would be right here. This is a high elevation area. The elevation at this point is about 800 to 1,000 meters above sea level, higher than Tagaytay. And it has hot springs right here running at the brooks. So you can imagine the weather as cool as Tagaytay, but with a hot spring of Pansol and Los Banos. So right here, so there's a wall, and then we are going to rehabilitate the forest so that this would be the source of water for the city itself. Then you see the connectivity also to the airport. This is 15 minutes away from the airport, and also with the seaports about 45 minutes going to the seaport. We are building the access roads already. It helps a lot that my former boss is now the Secretary of Public Works, so it's so easy to have the access roads built. Now he has committed to build all the roads going to it. I was his executive assistant in BCDA, so it helped a lot. And this is how the allocation of the land use will look like. So this is the industrial sites. We also have an agro-industrial site here. We are going to partner with Galat Kalinga to incorporate the farmers. So this is a farming community. We will train our farmers who are situated here to organic farming, and also provide food processing center that would, if you are involved in, for example, organic farming of tomatoes, you could vacuum pack your organic tomatoes in 2 minutes and then bring it to the airport in 15 minutes, and in 2 hours time, it will be in Hong Kong. In 4 hours time, it will be in Tokyo or in Singapore and KL. Because Clark is 4 hours away from any major Asia Pacific capital from the north to the south. So that would be, it will connect also our farmers to the global food market, and also increase the technology and also become a source of food within the city itself. So the food that the city will consume will be produced right in the city and the surrounding communities. So this is the commercial spaces. You see that it's located right around the lake, the central part. So it's the privacy area. Then we have the residential area also. You see the distribution of residential areas so that people will be able to easily walk towards their offices and the institutions. So this is the institutions. Well, UP had signed already. They're moving their global campus here. We have connected them with Massachusetts Institute of Technology to help them with the innovation district. So we are now discussing that and how to put up the innovation district. We have allocated about 500 hectares for the innovation district. So that would be distributed around the city. But mainly these are campuses, science high schools, research centers, incubator centers for entrepreneurs also, and residential area. So we will have hospitals as well, and a civic center for government offices. So if you need, let's say the Department of Foreign Affairs is located here, and you need a passport, and because you need a passport, you need your birth certificate. So what you're going to do is just go to the portal of the DFA, click a mouse that would request your data, your birth certificate, to the National Census Office, and then in a split second, the digital file of your birth certificate would be immediately sent to the Foreign Affairs, and you can have your passport in a few hours' time or even minutes. So this is the open space. As you see, that we have a cluster development to make it a walkable and livable city, but at the same time, we have farms and forest land. So on a weekend, you could go on biking, mountain trailing with your family and have a picnic and have a beautiful view of the central plains of Luzon, and have probably bathed in one of the hot springs right here. And you could have onsen or spa on the upland. So this is now the infrastructure access roads that are currently being built. The DPWH has already broken ground. They have mobilized the equipment right there that will connect it to MacArthur Highway. The roads of going here is already built up to right here. We have a bridge that connects the Freeport zone to the Clark Gate City. That has been built earlier. Then the road is already up to this point, and the DPWH will connect it up to the north. So what you see, the roads, these are the initial design. The roads, even the pavement of the road, would have porous design to absorb water. And also to, you have bike lanes with green belts right around the city. So now we need to connect it to the railway as well. When we completed the SETEX, the Subic-Clark Expressway, when we acquired the right-of-way expropriated land, we have already allocated the space for a railway line. So in fact, if someone wants to build a railway from Clark to Subic, they could immediately lay down the tracks because the land is already there and we own the land. So, but then here, to connect it to the city, we have asked the DOTs that we're going to represent building the Tutuban to Clark Airport to Clark Green City connectivity. And the model that we're adopting is the model of the NTR. So it is a mix of a rail and real estate development. Because we have so much land in the Clark Green City, we're going to provide and bring into the table 150 hectares of land. Land development in the Green City where the terminal will be located. So it's a transport-oriented development. It's about 150 hectares. And this will be a joint venture with BCDA because we have the legislative franchise to operate and construct a railway. Then we're going to build that. And we will acquire and expropriate the alignment along the road and within the stations itself. We're going to acquire bigger stations so that we will have parking spaces, commercial spaces within the alignment itself. So we're looking at 10 to 20 hectares of land space for the terminal for the railway project. So we are now, we have talked to NTR of Hong Kong if they're interested we're looking for partners now to do it. But definitely, we're putting in our land, even our franchise, for in our power to expropriate to develop this this project. We hope to be able to publish terms of reference for this in either next month or in July. So well, of course, part of disaster resiliency is also to vary the utility lines, so that when there's a typhoon or disaster, we could immediately rehabilitate the utilities, and we don't need to excavate every time we need to lay a fiber optic cable. Well, one thing also, Clark BCDA is suited for data centers because it's a very safe environment. There's no geohazard there, and we could immediately connect it with fiber optic lines using our right of way, using the tollways as the fiber optic highways. So you see that from Manila, you already have a tollway. Then from Subic, you have SETEX, PLEX, and CLEX. Actually, it's not only a highway for cars or trucks, it's also a fiber optic highway. So you could connect it with data centers located in Clark, Green City. We have engaged Cisco and Centios. We partnered with them. They provided us the advisory services as we plan the city to be an intelligent city. So there will be an integrated operation center in the city. The city will be managed. And of course, these are the incentives for whoever would want to partner with us. We get 5% from the gross income only, and tax and duty free importation. And for expatriates who are moving to the city, you have special visa. So encourage for all expatriates here to come live in Clark Green City. It's beautiful. So, and this is how the committed projects, of course, beautiful plans would not happen, but at the end of the day, the key is execution. So what are we doing to make it happen? One, we're already partnered with the PTP Center to build a food processing terminal. We have signed an agreement with Gawad Kalinga to integrate the existing farmers to put up the Agri-Innovation Hub for organic farming. We have signed up with the UP because this is the development of human capital. The Philippine Science High School is already in Clark. We are building another science high school together with the Department of Education right in the city. So we have from grade school to high school to university and even graduate and scholarships and research, there will be a space for the city. And starting it with the best university in the Philippines, which is the University of the Philippines. So, and the projects, when it comes to accessibility, we already have the Public Works doing it, and then the Public Fund, we're going to build 2,000 townhouses to create the kind of immediate population, about 2,000 families living immediately in the city. But it will also enhance further the value of other surrounding parcels that would be developed by other our partners. So this is the mixed-use development. We're looking for partners for industrial estate as well, for the innovation district. This could be schools, research centers, and other areas. Of course, we're also looking for partners for power. The feasibility studies are being done here. We actually received proposals already for the utilities. We could build our own power plant within the area, solar, waste to energy. Initially, what we need, because there's a dearth of power, we need to tap the grid for the base load capacity. But eventually, we're going to build our own capacity, so just the city will be powered by renewable energy. So. And of course, we're looking at the Texas Instruments already here. The high technology companies are already here. Texas Instruments, Samsung, Nanox, they're already here. They have thousands of workers. Yokohama produces 1 million tires a month in this in Clark. And Duventai produces your Ram Toran coach brand right here. So, and this is a timeline, the development plan, we're on track. The construction of private roads are ongoing. We are looking for partners, and we are going to next week. We're going to publish the terms of reference for the 288 hectare parcel of land. So we have revised the terms of reference to make it more attractive, and I hope everyone participates and look at the opportunity right here. So that's about the first development would be a 288 hectare development. It's a joint venture, just like what we did with BGC. We're not coming from zero. We're actually, look using our model, our success in BGC, and our track record in development, developing the city. So UP, we expect them to break ground next year, and of course, all these feasibility studies. Upon securing our joint venture partner, we're going to need to undertake the detailed master plan for the first 218 hectares. So, and that's the time we're going to devise the design guidelines and restrictions, taking into consideration the market conditions and also the phasing of the development, particularly. So, the site development will be next year. So, this is the next city, and this would serve as a benchmark for the entire country and how cities are built. We are sending mayors to Singapore for urban planning training. We have 50, we have partnered with Nanyang Technological University we are sending 50 of our people for urban planning training. And in fact, we have existing scholars now within the BCDA, with the School of Urban and Regional Planning. But at the same time, we're bringing them out of the country so that they'll be exposed to the best practices globally, and also, of course, the mayors, the surrounding cities and municipalities, we will help them come up with their own master plans so that we could consolidate a regional master plan for the metropolitan district of Central Luzon, starting with Clark Bay City. So that's it. I hope you participate and look forward to living in the city. Probably at least this one I can afford. Thank you very much.
That is extremely exciting. Very good. I mean, I had no idea that you guys were doing all of this. So this is going to, you know, you talk about legacies and things like this, but this is going to make a major impact. I had no idea Clark was this far advanced and so forth. So please, a hand for Arnel. This is a major important.